Members, owing to the nature of the next item of business in the order paper, I will not be chairing the debate, and I have been advised that the three deputy speakers will also be unable to do so. Standing Order 9A1 provides for these circumstances by requiring the sitting to be chaired by a temporary speaker. The temporary speaker is defined as the member present at the sitting who has served the Assembly the longest number of days and, in the case of a tie, the oldest of these. In accordance with Standing Order 9A1, I therefore ask Lord Morrow to take the chair, and I invite members to take their ease while we change the top table.
Members, the next item on the order paper is the motion of no confidence in the Speaker. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 2 hours for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall List. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I'd like to inform members that I have been advised by officials that a valid petition of concern has been presented today in relation to the motion of no confidence in the Speaker. Under Standing Order 28, the vote cannot take place until at least one day past. The vote will therefore be taken at the beginning of business tomorrow morning, Tuesday, the 17th of January. I'd like to remind members that the vote will be on a cross-community basis. I will now ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly has no confidence in the Speaker of the Assembly, believes that his position is untenable as he has compromised the independence and integrity of the office of Speaker, and calls for his immediate resignation.
Mr. Beggs.
Would the acting speaker confirm whether or not there is a petition of concern? The speaker will have the confidence of this assembly if the members indicate it that they have it, or he will not have it if the members indicate that he does not have it, irrespective of whether or not there is a petition of concern.
I ask Mr. Beggs to repeat his question. We are not clear what you mean.
Would the acting speaker confirm whether or not there is a valid petition of concern will not determine whether or not the speaker has the confidence of the members of this assembly, and no petition of concern will change that outcome. It will be by the votes of the members of this assembly.
Could I just remind Mr. Beggs and the House that this will be a decision for the Speaker himself, not for me to make. Thank you. I will now call on Mr. Conor Murphy to move the motion. Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Speaker. I read carefully the letter that the Speaker sent to all of the MLAs recently explaining his course of action and decision-making in relation to the sitting pre-Christmas. And it's quite clear, except that the Assembly was recalled on the basis of instruction from the First and Deputy First Minister, and he required similarly both ministers to instruct not to recall the Assembly. I don't think anyone has an issue with the fact that the Speaker hadn't got the authority to countermand the order to recall the Assembly. However, it was made very, very clear to him, both publicly and privately, to the Speaker's office, that the statement that was to be made and the purpose of the recalling of the Assembly was not in fact then being made on behalf of the office of the First and Deputy First Minister. The Deputy First Minister had withdrawn his authority for that statement to be made. That meant that the statement that the then First Minister came forward with was very clearly a personal statement on her own behalf and not the purpose for which the House was recalled. Bear in mind, there was all the business tabled for that day. It wasn't the sole purpose for which the House was recalled. So quite clearly, the original purpose that had been intended was gone. The Speaker should not have accepted the First Minister to make a statement claiming to be on behalf of the Office of the First and Deputy First Minister when clearly she was not and had not got the authority of that office to do so. In taking that decision, I think it was very clear, and the actions on the day I think reaffirmed that the Speaker not only was challenged very vigorously in relation to the standing orders on which he was conducting his business, which I have to say most of us were quite bemused as to some of his explanations, but also that he had lost the confidence, with the exception of his own party colleagues, of virtually every other MLA in this House. And I would suggest that he still has not got the confidence, with the exception of his party members, of virtually every other MLA in this House. And so we come today to debate confidence in the Speaker, which is a normal motion given the circumstances that we found ourselves in that sitting before Christmas and the behaviour that led to the First Minister making a statement on behalf of that office when clearly she hadn't got the authority to do so. But yet we find ourselves hamstrung by a petition of concern. And the DUP have deployed petitions of concerns over 80 times in this Assembly, 82 of those as a party on their own. And the irony is that the petition of concern was built into the Good Friday Agreement to protect the rights of minorities, to protect citizens from larger parties here trampling over their rights and their entitlements. And yet the DUP as a party themselves, the largest party in this Assembly, have used it 82 times without support from any other MLA in this Assembly. And on a number of those occasions, they have used it to protect their own members from censure within this Assembly. And they do so again on this occasion. Mr. Weir might find this amusing, but they do so again, and that is a matter which the DUP have yet to learn, that there is the public outcry in relation not just to this scheme, the Speaker's handling of some of these issues, but the DUP's absolute refusal to recognise the damage they're doing to public confidence in these institutions, and continue to do to this very moment when they deployed that petition of concern. The use of petition of concern to protect the interests of their own members is a corruption of what the petition of concern was intended to do. No, I'm going to finish what I have to say. Thank you very much. The use of petition of concern is a corruption of these institutions, and it's corruption something that the DUP would be very well to look to see how they deal with. And as a consequence, we are now to have a debate in this institution in relation to an important matter, which is confidence in the Speaker, with the outcome already decided. The outcome has been frustrated, regardless of every other MLA, with the exception of the DUP members' vote expressing their lack of confidence in the Speaker. That outcome will be overturned by the use of a petition of concern, put in the Good Friday Agreement to protect minorities, but used in a corrupt fashion by the DUP to protect their own. On those grounds, Mr. Speaker, I will not be moving this motion. I don't believe there's any purpose in keeping people here for a debate with which the outcome is predetermined. And I think the corruption of this institution in the eyes of the general public has to stop. And I hope that if the DUP reflect on this in the run-up to this election, that we get a different DUP returning here on the other side of the election. Thank you very much.
Can I ask the House to take its ease a moment, because that brings into question whether in fact the amendment can be moved since the motion has not been moved, but we will return to that in a moment or two. I've asked the House to take its ease. I'll come to you in a moment or two. Thank you. Order, members. Since the substantive motion has not been moved, therefore the amendment cannot be moved. So, yes, I'll take your point of order in a second. So I want members to understand that since we don't have a motion before us, then we don't have an amendment. Mr. Farrey.
Point of order. Thank you, Mr. Acting Speaker. It is somewhat the lazy convention in this House, particularly on motions such as this, that the person making the proposal doesn't necessarily say the words, "I move this." But I would make the point that, by implication, given that Mr. Murphy started speaking and indeed was allowed to make a speech, by implication, he has moved the particular motion. And that, therefore, that the item and business cannot, the only grounds which it can proceed is if there is a request by leave of the House that the item be withdrawn. Mr. Murphy has made a number of points in relation to his view on the issue, which has been read into the record, and he has taken that opportunity and indeed perhaps even abused the procedures of the House in doing so. And no other members are therefore afforded the opportunity to give their perspective on the issue or indeed to counter the points that have been made by Mr. Murphy. So I would maintain, by the fact that Mr. Murphy started speaking rather than saying "I move" or "don't move" the motion at the start of his speech, by implication he has therefore moved the business, and therefore the House should continue with the debate and proceeding to the amendment and other speakers.
In response to Mr. Farrey, I may have some sympathy with what you're saying. However, Mr. Murphy made it quite clear that he was not moving the motion, so he has. Well, whether it was at the end or the beginning, he has made it quite clear, and I don't have a motion before the House today, and that's the position. Mr. Dixon.
Thank you. Further to my colleague Dr. Farrey's comments, temporary speaker, is it not always also the situation that, in fact, the correct wording, and again, it goes back to somewhat lax language in this chamber, but when members withdraw, or ministers, as we've seen or heard in the past, withdraw various things for technical reasons, it is done, and I quote the words, "by the leave of this House." No leave has been sought from this House. Mr. Murphy made his comment in the middle, well into the middle of a speech, by certainly the time I spotted on the clock. I do not believe, Mr. Speaker, that Acting Speaker, that he has the authority to withdraw it, and we have an absolute right to this debate.
Mr. Dixon, can I say this to you? I'm long enough about this House, and I suspect there's others also, to know that there was a similar motion here in 2001, I think it was, and there was a debate, and the motion was not moved then. So therefore, if it had been done in that way, I think then there was more validity in what you are saying. And again, I'm not unsympathetic to what you're saying, but I have to make a ruling on it as the acting chair here today. And that is my ruling. Thank you. Members, it's my intention not to take any more points of order on this particular matter. Hold on. Hold on. Mr. Alistair. I'm asking you to sit down. Thank you. I'm not taking any more points of order on this particular matter. If members want to come to this issue at another time, that's entirely a matter for them. I'd ask the House now to take his ease. Thank you.
Senior Arden came to stay here. Members, in consultation with the Speaker's office and some of the senior clerks here, I'm going to suspend the Assembly here just at this moment because of the absolute mess that we have arrived into, to take some advice as to what is the best way forward, because there's a lot of issues, a lot of questions to be dealt with here in a serious manner without the tomfoolery, to be honest with you, that has been happening here. So, I can't take any point of orders, please, Mr. Allard, if you'll bear with me, and he will know that I'm saying that with the best possible wish. I'm not seeking to in any way curtail debate or anything. It's just I've been asked within the last 2 or 3 minutes to take this position, and I want to make sure that the advice that's given is appropriate and best in the best interests of the Assembly. Okay. So, by your leave, I'm asking for suspension of the Assembly until such times as we get back in here and have worked our way around this. Okay? Let's see, it's 10:02. Till 7:30. I've advised Mr. Farrey, I've already advised Mr. Allister behind you, I'm not taking any points of order. Well, I think the presumed advice is that we suspend until 7:30. If you want to have a chat with me, perhaps afterwards, that's grand. Okay.
Order. Order, members. I have taken the opportunity to consider the recording of Mr. Murphy's contribution in the last debate, and it is very clear that only at a very late stage he indicated he would not be moving the motion. Speaker's ruling 4.2G makes it clear that by convention, when a member no longer wishes to put a motion before the Assembly, he should say not moved, giving a short explanation to the House. It is very regrettable that Mr. Murphy did not observe the substance of this convention this evening when he was called to move the motion. However, the temporary speaker ruled that the motion was not moved. He has made his ruling, and it is not in order to challenge that. Standing Order 1-2 states that the Speaker's ruling shall be final on all questions of procedure and order. Point of order, Mr.
Whilst accepting the ruling that you have just given, the very fact that you had to give the ruling in the way you gave it is a clear indication of an inadequacy in the standing orders of this House, or indeed in the observation of conventions, whether or not they are covered by standing orders. Will you please agree to raise with the Speaker, in the hope that this matter may be referred to officials who could give us some better advice should this House be reconvened after the 2nd of March?
Thank the Member for his point of order, and I've listened and noted it carefully. And it may well be that, that a future or the next Assembly will consider these matters in some detail in terms of their procedures. I will also undertake to draw it to the attention of the Speaker, but that is somewhat invidious given that the motion before the House was a motion of confidence about the Speaker. Point of order, Mrs. Long.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank you for your ruling, and I understand the rationale behind it. I believe that the Speaker at the time cited precedent from the First Assembly. However, it's clear that poor precedent should never outweigh what is seen as good practice. And so would it be possible to compare the poor precedent from, I believe, was the First Assembly, which met in this chamber, with the intention of the ruling under Erskine May, which is that no one should be able to make a statement to the House without other members having the opportunity to respond to it.
I thank the member for a point of order, but the member, I think, well knows that current standing orders, standing order 1-2, as I've indicated, states that the Speaker's ruling shall be final on all questions of procedure and order.
and it is on that restriction that I make the judgment that I make. I think the member has put on the record suggestions which may or may not be considered by this Assembly or indeed any future Assembly. Point of order, Dr. Farrey.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Your ruling is very clear, and I thank you for that. But in essence, what you have set out is that an error was made in terms of the initial ruling. And also at that stage, a number of members were seeking to make points of order because of their concern about the potential that that ruling would have for the debate at that particular time. Can I therefore just seek reassurance that, given that a ruling was made by what was an acting speaker, so we have a difficult context, that in no way will that ruling therefore become a precedent for this House in terms of future business, given, as my colleague has said, that the wider guidance is provided by Erskine May in such circumstances?
The member for his point of order. Could I say I've been very clear in expressing my regret that Mr. Murphy did not observe the substance of conventions of this House this evening. But I am bound by Standing Order 1-2 that states that the Speaker's ruling shall be final, and that includes Speaker, Deputy Speaker and Temporary Speaker. Point of order, Mr. Nesbitt.
You're very clear in quoting Standing Order 1-2 and the impact it has on the fact we cannot challenge the decision. For the avoidance of doubt, can you point to the Standing Order under which the Acting Speaker made the decision?
Thank Mr. Nesbitt for his point of order. But it is clear to me and clear to officials that the ruling of a temporary speaker carries the full weight and authority of the Speaker's chair. Point of order, further to that point of order, Mr. Nesbitt.
But to be clear, while I am not challenging 1-2, you are not pointing to any standing order under which the acting speaker made his decision. That is correct.
Thank you for that point of order, Mr. Nesbitt. Unhappily, unlike perhaps himself, I was not in the chamber at the time. But it is clear, however, that Standing Order 1-2 covers the actions and the authority and has the full weight and authority of Speaker, Deputy Speakers and Temporary Speaker. Mr. McCann, point of order.
You said, Mr. Speaker, just now, that whatever the Speaker or Deputy Speaker or Acting Speaker's decision is final. Sir, this cries out against reason. Reason cries out against this idea. This cannot be true. This cannot be the situation, because the implication of it is that no matter what the Speaker or Deputy Speaker or Acting Speaker does, we simply must accept it. This is not, and the reason why, sir, you did not answer the question as to what standing order, under what standing order, that you were making this determination is quite simple. There is no such standing order. What we've had here is someone simply pulling the plug on this debate. Whether it was because it suited him personally or because it suited his party, I don't know. But it was absolutely improper. The situation we have now have is that as a result of a petition of concern from the DUP and the fact that the walkout by Sinn Féin put the two together, and what it means is that the minimal powers that we might have had of scrutiny of this matter are taken away from us. This is not just a matter of procedure.
Order.
This is a matter of the credibility
order.
Of people who have got... With hundreds of order. Millions of quid have been up and spoken, and we're saying that somebody can sit in that chair and simply say...
I resume your seat.
Well, I resume my seat no matter, but I'll tell you what, you're wrong, Morris was wrong, and what we ought to do is to get on with the business
order.
Of discussing the Renewable Heat Initiative.
Order.
Disgraceful. Makes a mockery of this House. What is the point of us being here? What's the point of us being here?
Order.
And we cannot discuss a matter which has been talked about and every pub
seat.
And every pub and street north
of
south.
I ask the member to resume his seat, and can I say to the member, no amount of drama or hysterics is going to lend any credence to the argument that you make. Because order. The simple fact is that standing orders, I accept, is silent on certain matters. But where it is clear, Mr. McCann, is that under Standing Order 1-2 states that the Speaker's ruling shall be final on all questions of procedure and order. And on that basis, that ruling applies to the Speaker, to the Principal Deputy Speaker, to the Deputy Speakers, and to any temporary Speaker. You may not like that rule. There may be opportunities in the future for this House to review that rule. But those are the rules as they are currently constructed.
Mr. Clark. Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. Can we clarify whether or not there has been an inference made that the Acting Speaker was working on his own guise? Can we get clarification or not whether he was working on the advice from the officials?
Further to that, that point of order, that is not a matter that I can comment on, and I think the member well knows that I'm not in a position to make comment on that or even to speculate on that, and I'm not sure that it's terribly helpful that the member does so. Mr. Weir has been patient.
I appreciate you can't speculate on that, but is it in order for a member to question the integrity of the chair in terms of the motivation that he made a decision on, which the last or the speaker before one did?
Further to that point of order, I'm in the happy position that I didn't hear everything that the member said, and sometimes that's an advantage. It's an advantage as a minister, it's an advantage as a member, and it's certainly an advantage when you're deputy speaker.
The previous speaker, Mr. McCann, questioned the integrity of the decision made by the chair, that this might be motivated by some personal motivation. I'm seeking clarification on whether it's appropriate for a member to challenge the integrity of the chair in terms of their motivation in making the decision.
That in my view, it will be a matter for those members accused to address. It is not a matter that I can give attention to in the heat of this debate at present.
Standing Order 65 is very clear in regards to order in the Assembly. And in the previous debate, when Lord Morrow was chairing it, Mr. McCann was very clear. He said that I am directly challenging your authority. He has also, I believe, acted now in a way which has brought the Assembly into disrepute by the way in which he's conducted himself.
Order.
He has shown complete order. Disregard for the chair, and
order.
I don't think that's appropriate.
Can I ask the member to resume his seat? Can I strongly advise the member to allow the chairing of proceedings to those who are appointed to thus do? And I'm not sure that your advice is any more helpful or useful than some of the other contributions. But you have had the opportunity to put your comments on the record.
Can you confirm the reason why this situation has developed is because a member from Sinn Féin rose to their feet, gave a speech, and then indicated at the end of that they weren't moving their motion, and that the outcome that was issued by the chair, acting chair in terms of the Lord Morrow, the direction that was issued from the chair would have been the same direction, regardless of who occupied the chair?
The member largely makes a political observation. I have clearly set out my ruling on this issue, and I think that is clear to all members present in the chamber. We must move on.
If Mr. Murphy did not speak in a debate, does he have the privilege of this House?
That is a matter that I would need to give further consideration to and due consideration, and I'm not sure that I'm in a position to answer that this evening. What is abundantly clear, and which I have made absolutely clear, it is that it is very regrettable that Mr. Murphy did not observe the conventions of this House when he was called to move the motion. Whether or not that affords protection is, I think, a more legal matter than I am able to answer at this point. Members?